Hi, welcome to Garden Wise Guys. I'm Billy Goodnick.
And I'm Owen Dell. Today we're going to show you how to have a beautiful, functional, sustainable landscape that will save water and save you money.
Experts from many disciplines agree that climate change is a reality. You're probably already modifying your driving habits and buying energy-efficient appliances. But did you know that there's things you can do in your landscape that will make a big difference?
Now, you've probably seen these TV shows where they go out in the wilds of Idaho or Washington looking for some big primitive monster. Well, did you know that Santa Barbara has its own primitive, nasty, environmentally destructive monster living right here in our community?
Day 37. We're here in base camp. We've been looking for big footprint everywhere in Santa Barbara. We've seen a lot of signs, but we haven't made contact. We're running out of supplies. If we don't find him soon, we're gonna have to go home.
Big footprint, a primitive throwback to a time when people just didn't care about how much carbon they left behind. Our job is to detect him, capture him, bring him back to civilization, try to change his ways.
What's that?
It might be big footprint.
Big footprint.
Let's go.
Let's go. You got the gear?
Yeah.
There it is. Ah. Stand back. Stand back. Yep. 21st century power mower. Obvious sign Bigfoot's around here somewhere.
Sure enough. You know, these things are a mess. All this powered lawn and garden equipment, the weed whackers, the edgers, the mowers. They're terribly inefficient. They use a huge amount of fuel for the work that they do, and they create an enormous amount of pollution. They're really a problem. You know, they could have used a push mower or even an electric mower. It's a whole lot lower impact than these things.
Well, not only that, but these things are just noisy. They're rough on the neighbors, and they scare away the other creatures.
Speaking of noise,
yep, picking up carbon.
Looks like big footprints been here too, huh?
Yeah. Well, look at this. Okay, this flagstone. And this doesn't come from around here. This is Arizona flagstone, which means, guess where it comes from? Arizona. Which means it had to be taken out of the earth using big power equipment, all the emissions.
And trucking,
that.
Right? Like driving it here.
Exactly. Then it has to move all this distance. And right here next to it is Santa Barbara sandstone. And I think you all know where that comes from. Okay. So, you know, wherever we can use local materials instead of importing stuff and driving it around and extracting it from the earth, there's less of a carbon footprint.
They could have used urbanite, too.
Urbanite, that's chunks of concrete.
It's the new mineral.
That's right. It's like a mineral.
And it's beautiful.
You can color it, you can texture it. There's a lot you can do. So no sense breaking up concrete, sending it to the dump, and then bringing in flagstone.
Wait. That's true. But look, check this out. Another sign of big footprint.
You got it.
Aluminum lawn furniture. Aluminum lawn furniture is a disaster. There's so much energy that goes into making aluminum that it's just a catastrophe, because whenever you use energy, you're releasing greenhouse gases and you're becoming part of the problem. They could have used wood furniture, they could have used something salvaged. There's all kinds of alternatives to this kind of high-tech solution to sitting down. Same thing with the table.
Yeah, and another thing we find in so many gardens is plastic made out of petrochemicals. Doesn't hold up very well.
It's not in very good shape.
More energy, more carbon going out into the environment. Another little environmental impact.
And plastic is terribly polluting. The manufacturer, everything.
Look what we got underneath it. This pea gravel, they're using it for drainage underneath this, but this makes a perfectly good patio.
Pervious, water goes through it.
Yeah, and it's been the floor of gardens for thousands of years, so look into it.
Yeah.
Wait a minute. I'm getting something.
What?
Hey, you haven't seen carbon footprint, have you? No? Okay.
Do you smell methane?
Oh, that's another greenhouse gas. Come on, let's move on. We're getting a little closer. Even though this is like H2O, there's a lot of CO2 in this as well. The CO2, the carbon, is from all the energy that goes into moving water, transporting water, processing water so that we can drink it. Also, you know, California, we have the State Water Project. That's the largest electricity user in the entire state. So it might look like water to you, looks like carbon to us.
Mm-hmm. And you know the other thing? All this water waste, and what have they got? An ugly mud hole. This could have been used to grow food or native plants, or almost anything is better than this. It isn't even a nice looking lawn.
Yeah, so
what a terrible missed opportunity.
Take out the lawn, make it smaller, just get rid of it completely.
Absolutely.
Okay, I think we're getting close. Why don't we follow this?
Here, it goes over here.
Okay, follow me. Follow me.
More evidence. Stucco. Not from around here. More flagstone. Not from around here. We're getting closer to big footprint.
Yeah, and you know what? In addition to the transport problem with this, concrete production generates a huge amount of CO2. It's a big problem. Yeah. Now, there are some alternatives.
Sure.
For example,
our old friend.
Native, let me guess, Santa Barbara sandstone, or it could be Goleta sandstone, or Carpinteria sandstone. A local material, you could dry stack it up without any concrete at all. It makes a gorgeous, gorgeous wall. This could even have come from your own backyard. The cost is low, and it's actually, I think, a lot more attractive than this high-tech solution that we have here.
So, we're on the trail.
Yeah.
Maybe we take this along that a little.
Well, we might run into Bigfoot, and we might, you know, need that.
Hey, Owen.
Yeah.
Something's wrong. I've lost my carbon signal.
What?
No, it's just, this is just like pure. Come out of my way.
Here, go ahead.
Well,
wait a minute. Look at this.
Okay,
what's
we got
this?
Low water using ground cover.
Look at this food.
He's growing.
This can't
own?
Possibly okay. Be big footprint.
Is that a chicken coop?
Boy, it looks like it. Good chickens.
Hey, aren't you the garden wise guys?
Yeah.
I've been watching your show. I've been learning a lot, starting to make some changes around here.
Yeah? Like what?
I stopped using the mower and started using a push mower.
That's good.
I took out some of the lawn here and been planting crops.
Yeah, great.
I've been looking at other changes I can make in the hardscape. Yeah. I've been learning a lot from you guys, using some local materials.
It's great that the show's having some influence. So, you know, it's impossible to get the carbon completely out of the landscape, but we hope some of the things we pointed out here to you will help you put your own garden together. Give me that! Why, I yada.
Well, it's nice to know we had a positive effect, huh?
Yeah, that was great. For more information on how to reduce your carbon footprint, visit sbwater.org.
We'll be right back.
Leaving the water running while brushing your teeth wastes 2 gallons of water. For more information on how to conserve water, log on to www.sbwater.org. That's sbwater.org.
Fixing a leaky faucet can save 20 gallons a day. Filling your dishwasher can save 25 gallons a day. Shortening your shower to 5 minutes can save 40 gallons a day. Saving water? Priceless.
Welcome back. In addition to buying locally, it's important to know how fossil fuels play a role in the garden.
Up next, we're premiering a new game show about how fossil fuel use and wasteful energy consumption find their way into our lives.
It's called The Greenest Loser.
Hi, I'm not Alex Trebek, and welcome to The Greenest Loser, the game show where correct answers lower your carbon footprint. And the person with the lowest score ends up getting the most carbon-neutral gifts. Let's welcome tonight's contestants. We have first Otis Ganagahyde, a bowling therapist from Altoona, Pennsylvania, and Dexter Grievance, a computer toner technician from Wagon Rut, South Dakota. Ready to start the game?
Yeah, certainly.
Okay. You want to pick a category?
I'll have power lawn and garden equipment for 100 pounds of carbon.
What is the difference between a gas-powered lawnmower and the Exxon Valdez?
Well, Alex, first of all...
I'm not Alex.
Sorry. Okay. First of all, if the Exxon Valdez is a ship, it's a big thing. You couldn't possibly mow a lawn with it, right?
Maybe a little boat, you could mow a lawn, but a ship, and then the lawnmower, I mean, come on. Did you ever try to float a lawnmower? They go right to the bottom.
Oh, I'm sorry, your time is up. Let's go to the Garden Wise guys in the field with a correct answer.
In fact, the difference between this lawnmower and the Exxon Valdez is not much. Americans spill over 17 million gallons of gasoline every year just refueling power lawn and garden equipment. That's more than was spilled by the Exxon Valdez in Alaska.
Not only that, but according to the EPA, Americans use over 800 million gallons of gasoline a year fueling mowers and other power equipment. So what can we do about it? If you absolutely need to keep some lawn for recreational purposes, you can downsize it, mow it with a push mower. Or better yet, remove the lawn completely, grow something edible. That way we're not wasting and we're not spilling gas. Okay, Otis, it's your turn. Please pick a category. How about transportation for 300 pounds of carbon? Transportation. Well, I hope you're good at algebra. Here's your question, Otis. An azalea in Santa Barbara needs a pound of nitrogen per year. A truck leaves El Paso, Texas, heading west at 65 miles per hour with a fuel consumption of 10 miles per gallon and drives into a headwind of 10 miles per hour. Now, please, solve for X. Solve for X. Okay, so my wife's attorney called you because I'm all straight with my ex. I'm paying child support, and I think the alimony check cleared, so you know, we should... Okay, well, that's not really an answer, so good try, but obviously not too good in algebra. Great. So let's cut to the Garden Wise guys in the field. Let's get the correct answer. Transportation of lawn and garden products is a waste of fuel and releases a lot of greenhouse gases. Did you know that more fertilizer is used in American gardens than in the rest of the world for food production? Pretty amazing. Not only that, but 3 million tons of petrochemical-derived fertilizer goes into our lawns.
And not only that, 60% of the nitrogen that's applied to lawns ends up in the groundwater or going off into the streets as runoff. It's incredible. What's the solution? It's simple. If you create a garden that is adapted to our climate, doesn't need that many resources, then you don't need to use the fertilizer, you don't need to transport things, and you don't need to create all these problems. You've got it made. It's really just that simple.
Well, no correct answers yet. You know, who's screening these contestants? We got to do a little bit better job. Okay, Dexter, this one's for you.
Oh, I'll take PVC as oil for 500 pounds of carbon.
Okay, name three uses for plastic in the landscape.
Okay, Alex.
I'm not Alex.
Sorry.
Plastic flamingos and those garden gnomes, those little plastic, and beer cups.
Normally that could be considered a correct answer, yeah. But it's not what we were looking for. So once again, let's go to Garden Wise guys in the field for the correct answer. Boys?
Although gardens have gotten along fine without plastics for thousands of years, modern gardeners seem to be hooked on the stuff, especially PVC. Experts tell us that PVC is among the most hazardous materials ever created, and you find it in everything from sprinkler pipe, lawn furniture, pots, even fences.
Aside from the environmental costs of just producing these materials, it takes in the order of 8 nuclear power plants to generate enough power and electricity just to create these. So what can we do? We can plant gardens that are low water using and aren't dependent on a lot of irrigation and PVC pipe. We can use natural materials like wood for our furniture, and we can use ceramic for our plant containers. A lot less energy going in, we do away with the PVC. Not only that, but if we use drip irrigation instead of traditional pop-up type sprinklers, we can use this polyethylene pipe, which is recyclable. Great benefit. Okay, this is getting a little old. Boys, put on your thinking cap, see if you can burn just a couple of brain cells on this one. Otis, your turn. Let's pick a category. Transportation for 1,000 pounds carbon. Transportation for 1,000. Okay. What is the average distance that food travels from its source to your dinner plate. Four blocks? Yeah, 4 blocks. That's how far it is from the cholesterol king house of hot dogs to my house. 4 blocks. That's my final answer. Ah, yes, the old cholesterol. Guess what? Another wrong answer. Isn't that amazing? Okay, we're going to the Garden Wise guys for the correct answer.
Well, Owen, what's the answer?
Well, the answer is that food, on average, travels 1,500 miles from farm to plate in the United States. Now, that's just not going to work out. It's causing all those same climate implications that we've talked about with all the other things. So, Billy, what's the solution, do you think?
Well, the solution is one thing, like we're doing here, is growing our tomatoes and other produce locally. You can grow fruit trees in an orchard. You can grow tomatoes or seasonal vegetables, whatever you like, right here in your own backyard. The transportation distance, the carbon release, don't worry about it. It's going from the backyard to the kitchen table. Also, we have some great fruit and vegetable stands around our area, and we have the farmers markets that are available just about every day of the year in the Santa Barbara area. Although there's a little bit of transportation involved, it's coming from within the region, so the impacts are a lot less than the 1,500-mile diet.
And you can share it with your friends and neighbors, too.
Exactly.
It's a lot of fun.
Oh, this has been so much fun. Great. 20 minutes left on the show. We don't have a single right answer. My career is, like, finished, so I'm going to make a phone call to my agent. I'm out of here. Okay. See ya. Thanks a lot.
Bye, Alex.
I'm not Alex.
Okay, so the game show idea didn't work, but here's the point we're trying to make. Billy?
When you design your garden in a sustainable way, you not only avoid harm to the environment, but you create a climate-friendly landscape.
We'll be right back.
My mom always told me to conserve water. She says that it helps the environment and prevents future droughts. She installed low-flow shower heads and always did a full load of laundry and dishes. She planted water-wise plants and used her broom to clean up outdoor messes instead of the hose. So what can I do? I know. Save water. Everyone can do it.
Hi, I'm Kathy Perret with the City of Santa Barbara Water Resources with your irrigation tip of the day. Today we're talking about rain sensor controllers. They're going to shut your water off when it's raining. When you're on vacation and it's raining, you don't have to worry about it. It's kind of a nice thing. We're actually at the Santa Barbara Lawn Bowlers Club here, and they use recreational lawn all the time. One of the important things is you don't want to overwater it, you don't want to underwater it. We're trying to do what Mother Nature does. When it rains, we turn off our irrigation, and in the summertime, we water only what's necessary. One of the first things to do when you're going to put in your rain sensor is you got to find your irrigation controller. It's usually on the side of your house, tucked in behind the bushes where you don't see it. So go on out, see if you can find it, and then I'm going to give you some tips on how to install this. The first thing you're going to do is you're going to install the actual rain sensor portion of this where it gets rain directly in the top of this nozzle. Meaning underneath the gutters, push it out so that it gets the rain. Don't put it underneath the tree. Don't stick it right next to it where it's under the eaves, but put it right out in the rain. Run the wire down to your controller, and you know, this is where you're going to need your tool belt. Let's see. 2 screwdrivers, either one will work. You're going to open it up, you either want a Phillips head or a regular one. And when you look in here, you're going to see a bunch of different wires. There's usually one that says sensor. There's a little jumper wire here, and you're going to unscrew that, take that jumper wire out, and you're going to replace that jumper wire with the 2 wires on the end of your rain sensor. They're different colors. Don't worry about it. You can go left or right, right or left, either one. Put one up in one side and tighten it in. And then you're going to stick the wire up in the other screw hole here, and you're going to tighten it in. So as you finish tightening this last little wire into the sensor screw, and you're installing this, you're probably wondering, where can I get one of these? Well, if you're a resident of the City of Santa Barbara or in the Goleta Water District, you can get one for free. If you go to either of the water agency's websites and give them a phone call or fill out an application, you can get a voucher and you can get one of these for free for each of your controllers.
Welcome back to Garden Wise Guys. In this episode, we're talking about how to create earth-friendly landscapes.
And in this segment, we're going to introduce you to some trees that do really well in our climate, and we're going to discuss their role in creating a climate-friendly landscape.
People love to come to Alice Keck Park Memorial Gardens to look at the beautiful trees, but did you know they also play a very important role in creating a climate-friendly landscape around your home, for your neighborhood, and for the community?
Trees produce oxygen through their leaves, but they also absorb greenhouse gases like carbon dioxide and actually hold it in the tissue for the life of the tree.
We love the shade of a tree when we're out in the garden or the park, but also if trees are properly placed to shade the house, keeps it cooler inside, more comfortable, saves some energy. If it's a deciduous tree that drops its leaves in the winter, it also allows the sunshine in when we really welcome it.
And finally, trees absorb air pollution through their leaves and their roots. How cool is that?
It's pretty cool. Talking about global cooling. This is a New Zealand Christmas tree. Great tree. I like to use it in designs because it fits in so many situations. Looks great in Mediterranean style landscaping. It's got this distinctive grayish bark and dark shadows in it, and grows in a very even sort of shape, rarely needs any kind of pruning. So it's a very manageable type of tree. It's drought tolerant, doesn't get so tall that it might be a problem under utility lines, and it has a non-aggressive root system, so you don't have to worry too much about putting it near sidewalks. Great tree, nice color, not really over the top sort of red, but blends in nicely. Love to use this tree, give it a try.
Here's a great tree that everybody knows, the Valencia orange. Citrus are fantastic. They're evergreen, really pretty much unbeatable. Now, citrus do get a few pest problems, but they're very, very easily handled through integrated pest management techniques without using any chemicals. One of the good practices under citrus and really under any tree is to use a layer of about 3 to 4 inches of organic mulch, wood chips, bark, or whatever. The mulch will protect the roots of the tree, hold the water in, keep the weeds down, keep the soil temperature even, and return nutrients to the soil. So mulch is a really good practice under any tree.
Hey, Owen. Huh. Just found this really cool tree. You got to see this one. You know the leptospermum?
Yeah.
Let's go talk about it. I just planted one of these in my yard. I just can't wait till it, you know, develops some character.
You like this?
Yeah.
Yeah, right. About 2,158.
Oh, so yeah. I'll take my vitamins and we'll grow old together.
You do that.
Yeah.
You do that.
But it's a cool tree.
Hey, it's a very cool tree. In fact, it takes seashore conditions. It's drought tolerant. It's from a Mediterranean climate. It's a beautiful tree. It doesn't always look this crazy. If you have it in your patio, it's going to be a little more well-mannered than this, at least for the first 75, 80 years.
Yeah, after that, let it go.
Well, then who knows?
This tree is from Brazil. It's called a golden trumpet tree. The botanical name is Tabebuia. You can remember that. Michael, row the boat ashore. Okay. It's a deciduous tree, so the things we've been talking about trees that lose their leaves all at once in the wintertime, applies here. This will allow the sun to reach your home or reach a patio in the wintertime when you'd like things to warm up a little bit, but creates a nice shade canopy in the summertime. People feel deciduous trees are messy. Well, the news is all trees lose their leaves. There's no tree that holds it for its entire life. So I think it's more convenient to have all the leaves to rake up at once. Right now, it's just a beautiful, attractive green plant. The foliage is this nice five-pointed leaf. And when it's done flowering, it's got a really attractive sort of fruit. But in March, this plant is an absolute showstopper. Beautiful golden yellow trumpet flowers that cover the entire tree before the leaves come in. Really wonderful plant. It's worth planting in your yard. It's really a no-care tree once you've got it started and you've got it nicely pruned. So give Tabebuia a try.
You know, of all the trees that we've looked at, this is one of my favorites, and I really think it's one of the most appropriate trees for Santa Barbara, the local native coast live oak. It doesn't require watering. It doesn't require that much care. It's handsome, statuesque, just a gorgeous, gorgeous tree. Everyone's familiar with it, and it really should be protected and used more often. Now, there are a couple of things to think about if you happen to live under a coast live oak. First of all, not only do they not need water, they really don't want water. So you don't want to put lawn under an oak tree. You don't want to put high water use plants under an oak tree or have sprinkler systems shooting water, particularly toward the trunk. That's very, very important because you can start to kill the tree very quickly. Now, if you want to learn more about oaks, check out the Santa Barbara Botanic Garden. They have some great information on care of oaks and living under oak trees. We're here at Alameda Park across the street from Alice Keck. And you remember we were talking about trees that have aggressive roots that lift sidewalks and patios? Well, here's a great example. This is the Morton Bay fig tree. It's the same one that's down at the train station with the huge root system. Now, you probably wouldn't want to put this in your own yard, but you need to know that there are actually quite a number of species of trees of all kinds that have lifting roots, and you could get into trouble with them. Right, Billy?
Right. In fact, one of the solutions for that, well, first thing is if you can, keep the tree farther away from surfaces like foundations and sidewalks. But if you do have to nudge up a little bit closer, there's a device called a root barrier. It's just a big plastic sheet you put in a trench next to the sidewalk. When the roots reach it, they tend to go down and not disrupt the sidewalk. Another thing to keep in mind is that if you've got sewer lines, you generally don't want to put trees over them. Also, staying away from septic systems, because the tree roots are going to seek out that moisture and they're just going to cause headaches for you. If there is such a thing as a near-perfect tree for almost any yard in Santa Barbara, this one gets my vote. This plant is actually related to the manzanita that grows back in our foothills. It's got this gorgeous red bark all the time. It does not lose its leaves in the wintertime, and it's got beautiful fruit on it that look like strawberries and beautiful little almost porcelain-like flowers that hang down.
A young tree like this has to be pruned to train it so that it has a good form throughout its life. This particular tree is in pretty good shape. You can see that the branches go out from the center. They're alternating on the trunk for the most part, so they're going to have a very strong attachment to the trunk. There's not a lot of crisscrossing branches, but we do have a little work to do here. You can see that there are a few branches growing into the center, and they don't look so good. Not a big deal, but they need to be clipped off. Now, when the tree gets bigger, you're not going to be able to do this yourself, so what do? You want to look for a certified arborist, preferably certified by the International Society of Arboriculture. They have a great website, and you can look up local arborists and find out who's qualified to work on your trees, because a tree is a very valuable thing, and it needs to be taken care of by a qualified person, just like your expensive car needs to be cared for by a good mechanic.
Well, the point I like to make is just because somebody owns a chainsaw doesn't mean you necessarily want them working on your tree. I could probably buy some dental tools, but you don't want me filling the cavities in your mouth. So get a certified arborist and do it right. No, you're all right. So we've given you a lot of information about trees, and you probably need to do some additional research. There's always the Sunset Western Garden book, great starting place, but we've also got this fabulous book, Trees of Santa Barbara. This is the most recent edition. It's available at local bookstores and also at the Botanic Garden. And then there's that great website, Select Tree. So check all those things out. Do your homework.
Yeah. So we've learned quite a bit today. Basically, we found out that trees are climate friendly. They help save energy. They keep the surroundings cool. They absorb greenhouse gases, and they help to filter pollution. They're really handy to have around.
So do a little homework and go out and plant the right tree.
Well, thanks for watching the Garden Wise Guys. We hope you found some ways to green your own garden.
And for more information on the topics we've covered in this episode, visit sbwater.org. Thanks for watching.
See you next time.
I've been breathing PVC fumes, and I'm a little bit crazy.
But according to the EPA, the APE, which stands for APE,
if you create a garden that doesn't require very, 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 very...